Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The War for the Common Soldier, How Men Thought, Fought, and Survived in Civil War Armies, by Peter S. Carmichael, narrated by Walter Dixon. Introduction. Michigan's John Partington slept among the dead and the dying at Antietam. The slim, full-bearded 23-year-old awoke to smells and sights that exceeded his worst expectations of war. The battered landscape aroused Partington's curiosity as he left camp to get a closer view of the destruction. Partington was understandably intrigued, given that his regiment had missed the fighting on September 17, 1862. Just 2 months earlier, in response to Abraham Lincoln's call for 300,000 Union volunteers, John had quit his job as a store clerk, enlisted in the 24th Michigan Infantry, and said goodbye to his wife, Sarah, and their infant daughter in Trenton, Michigan. The mighty conflict that Partington could only imagine as something on a distant horizon was suddenly upon him. Partington only had to walk a stone throw of our camp to see bodies mangled by war. Hundreds of Confederate wounded lay sprawled before him, barely holding on to life, without an attending nurse or doctor.
"The awfulest sight you ever see, Sarah,"
a shaken Partington scribbled in a letter to his wife.
"Some dying, some legs off and arms, and they're as lousy as they can be. They're lying in barns and sheds just as they can get shelter. I go down and see them every day," he added. "There's one or two die every day. It is an awful sight."
His outpouring of sympathy, though deeply felt, did not soften his hatred for the Southern cause or temper his desire to kill a Confederate.
"Dear Sarah," he wrote, "I must now close, for I must clean my gun and keep in good fighting trim so I can pop a rebel every time."
Partington's bravado could not mask his struggles in deciphering God's intentions in such human suffering. He felt deeply for the Confederates wasting away in makeshift hospitals, even though he despised the rebellious cause and believed the fight to preserve the Union was a sacred one. Partington never countenanced the idea that God might abandon the North, yet he could not help but wonder about providential intentions after so much killing, when the prospect of peace appeared so distant. Was anything gained or lost from the slaughter of nearly 23,000 men in a single day at Antietam?
"God, grant it there has been enough lives sacrificed in this unholy war," he pleaded. "Now I should think if the headmen would see the suffering it has caused, they would close it at once."
Yet Partington was not sure if anyone could rein in the seemingly unstoppable conflict until both nations were drained of blood.
"But I hope for myself, if it is ever settled, it will be done satisfactory to both parties. If it ain't, let it go on till either side or the other is annihilated. It is very strong talk, but it must be so. But things sometimes look dark. But the darkest hour is just before day. We are on the right, and God will help us and favor our arms."
Despite his confident words, Partington worried that God's ways were not discernible. As with most Americans, John expected the war to follow a predictable cause and effect equation, in which divine favor would reward his people with victory. He discovered, as all soldiers did, that God ruled over man in ways that existed beyond human comprehension and control. The terrible images of Antietam stayed with Partington, but they never fully possessed his thoughts or owned his emotions. He rarely dwelled on the evils of war when writing home, always striving to be cheerful, believing that if he cultivated the right feelings, he would uplift his wife and protect her from the dangers of despair. Keeping spirits up throughout the war would be no easy task when his wife Sarah lived on the brink of destitution. She boarded with relatives out of financial necessity, often finding herself in the crosshairs of family squabbles, and at one point she considered cutting her hair for extra cash. All the while, Partington scraped by on the Army's irregular and paltry pay. When the financial demands became so severe Sarah considered going outside the home and taking a job, John flew into a rage. If she ever suggested working again, he would desert, and she would be responsible for his crime that would dishonor the family for generations to come. The incident passed, and Sarah remained at home, fulfilling John's idealized vision of their marriage as a partnership in war.
By all accounts, Sarah played the part, encouraging her husband to do his duty, to be a good Christian, and to know that their letters kept them emotionally connected. "Dear Sarah," John wrote in a typical letter, "God and your prayers give me strength and courage to pass through whatever may be my lot. I've put a little pocket in that blue flannel shirt right by my heart, and there you and baby lays night and day, that is the locket, the one you sent me last. I keep it in the Bible, and I carry that in my breast pocket. So you see, dear, I have you by me all the time and through every danger. I will try and not get you hurt."
As soon as Partington buttoned his blue sack coat and shouldered a musket, he turned to Sarah as his spiritual comrade in war. He beseeched her to pray for him in almost every letter. Her words soothed his emotions and inspired him to live a godly life. He put down the bottle and picked up a Bible, showing himself and Sarah his deep desire to live and fight like a Christian warrior. His high aspirations reflected the society that had sent him off to war. The North, like the South, looked to war as a moral purifier for men who would, through a disciplined and religious life in the ranks, achieve character. Partington promised to return home a different man. The shame of having surrendered to drink in his past clearly haunted him. There were too many memories of coming home full of whiskey and rage. What transpired during their late-night altercations is impossible to say from John's letters. But in admitting his sin, Partington found hope in the Lord's eternal promise of redemption. He also sought forgiveness from his wife. "Sarah," Partington pleaded, "if I could recall those nights, I would sacrifice my right hand. But you will forgive me, won't you, dear? And I make a faithful promise before God, if ever I get back to you, I will live a different life." Like so many northern and southern men, Partington underwent a conversion experience in the ranks, believing that fighting made the man, and that courage and piety were pillars of a dutiful soldier sacrificing for the nation by leaving his beloved wife and family behind. If the scenes from Antietam had caused Partington to wonder if God directed the war, then the disaster at Fredericksburg shattered his belief that wartime conduct would lead to predictable results. The useless slaughter of Union soldiers on December 13, 1862, showed Partington that acts of supreme courage, even when inspired by a just cause, could not defeat impregnable Confederate works or overcome bungling Union generalship. The deaths were indiscriminate, impersonal, and gruesome. Shell fragments tore into the bodies of comrades while he stood unharmed, leading him to think that God must have shielded him. And yet, Partington walked away from his first battle feeling out of spirits. He did not care how quickly they comprised this thing. Only a week later, he regained his emotional equilibrium when he reflected upon his own survival. Only Providence, he reasoned, could have protected him from death. "Thank God," Partington wrote, "I have come out safe, though our forces suffered terrible. And lucky enough for us that we left as we did, for had we stayed there another day, they would have completely destroyed our army." Partington's gratitude to Providence has to be placed side by side with his acknowledgement that luck and military field position determined who lived and who won. Partington composed a letter full of trepidation to Sarah on January 18th. "But I tell you, Sarah, I don't like much to cross that river in the same place as we did before. I would not care so much if we only had them on equal footing, but to take them where they are, behind such entrenchment and barricade, it don't seem fair." In the weeks that followed the Battle of Fredericksburg, Partington tried to avoid any talk of the dismal war situation. His letters were devotionals to Sarah, for in their love he generally found peace and contentment in the ranks. As with any soldier, however, emotions could master the man to the point that a longing for home could descend to the blues. On Christmas Eve, John felt his spirits sinking after seeing a close hometown friend who, "Whenever I look at him," he wrote to Sarah, "I think of you more. No one knows the feeling of a husband and father away from home," John confided, "and everything looks so discouraging and dark that I am almost sick and tired of it." Partington was edging toward a dark place in his letter, even though he knew, like most Civil War soldiers, that keeping one's spirits up demonstrated character, proved one's faith, and testify to the power of loving a woman. I pray for you and baby every night as I lay down, for God to keep you both in health and spirits. Sarah, I did not think a man could love a woman so as I love you today. Oh, that the time was come when I could clasp them once more to my breast. But keep up spirits, dear, for your John's sake. The bottom nearly fell out for Partington and the entire Army of the Potomac after Burnside's failed offensive at the end of January, which was derisively called the Mud March. Union morale plunged and desertion skyrocketed. But Partington would not budge from the ranks. Nothing could induce him to abandon the army. His reputation as a fighting man was too precious to risk. I would sooner be brought home in my coffin to you, as bad as I want to see you, dear. I never could desert. Sarah, I never could bring such disgrace to you and my little darling. Partington remained committed to military victory, but in his letters following Fredericksburg, he focused more on the hardships of soldiering than the idealism of the Union cause. After describing a trying rotation on picket duty, where he stood in the blowing snow for more than 24 hours without a fire, Partington reminded his wife that the trials of a soldier could not be imagined, but only experienced. Sarah, I never knew before what a man could stand. Talk about hardships. Here is where you will find them. Just before the opening of the Gettysburg campaign, Partington sent a cautionary letter to Sarah, reminding her that luck might bring victory to the enemy once again. He expected the rebels to maneuver toward Manassas, where Union armies had suffered a humiliating defeat in July 1861 and again in August 1862. Partington judged the Manassas battleground a favorite Confederate hunting ground for Yankees. That is a lucky battlefield for the rebels, John opined. If we should have one there, I hope it will prove lucky for us this time. At the same time, Partington could not imagine that God's hand would not direct military affairs. His lack of certitude about providential intentions is telling. Partington was likely reassuring himself as much as he was Sarah when he wrote, God prosper our arms if we do, for we are on the right side, and right as might, we all know. And yet he still suggested in the same letter that the campaign's outcome might hinge on luck. His confusion should not be interpreted as a loss of faith. He was only coming to terms with a war that was not easy to read. Even if misfortune struck, and the Army of the Potomac blundered into another death trap like Fredericksburg, Partington remained confident of one thing. He and his comrades would follow any order with unhesitating obedience. He could, as a result, look to the future with a measure of confidence, given that he would bear up with soldiers' fortitude. Partington's belief in soldiers' fortitude illustrates how much he had changed in less than a year of service. During those times, he struggled to find certainty about God and his will. John always knew in doing the job of soldier, he found the truth of his existence. He and his comrades had endured brutal marches in the field, punishing discipline in camp, and gut-wrenching fear in battle. No one who had not endured the same experiences could possibly question their standing as men of moral courage. His sense of duty drew its strength from relationships forged by experience in the ranks, and religious or patriotic rhetoric receded to descriptions of men suffering and sacrificing. Partington explained it very simply to Sarah. For I don't think it is hardly possible for me to come home this summer, he wrote on June 5th, for they need every man they got, and I don't think it's my duty to leave now when we are needed the most. If there were any doubts about his standing as a soldier, Partington could also point to the bullet-riddled flag of the 24th Michigan as indisputable evidence of his regiment's valor for the cause of the Union. The banner actually guided Partington's thoughts and actions, keeping him from applying for a furlough in early June, even though he wanted to see Sarah as much as he ever did. Military necessity demanded that every man shoulder a musket when there was a whiff of a coming campaign. He explained to his wife that when he saw the flag, he felt an overpowering love for her and his country. Not that I love you less than the good old flag, but, he added, I love that next to you, and will stick by it as long as she waves, for it is the only flag of the free. Partington predicted that preservation of the flag depended on the will of the individual soldier, who would have to keep killing until the national banner would
triumph over all other rags that are afloat against us now and ever.
John Partington's account is not the story of the common soldier of the Civil War, but his personal history shows how members of the rank and file learned to be flexible in thought and in action. It did not take long for Union and Confederate volunteers to appreciate how they were conditioned by the world they inhabited. Circumstances controlled Army life, and adaptability, more than any other trait, best describes how Union and Confederate soldiers navigated their world on a daily basis. A Minnesota soldier captured this perspective when he outlined the qualities most valued by the rank and file. "We want a man of greater flexibility of character, a man of rough and ready energy, who knows how to adapt himself to circumstances and men in all conditions of life."
Ideas never lost their importance to Civil War soldiers, but beliefs did not always lead to a predictable cause and effect pattern of rewards and punishments during a tumultuous armed conflict. Even as soldiers insisted that the war had a higher moral and political purpose, they struggled to find moral certitude in the waging of war. Acts deemed criminal in the civilian world suddenly seemed just, necessary, and essential to survival. The randomness with which men died in camp or were indiscriminately shot down on the battlefield was especially troubling, for it suggested the absence of an orderly universe based on divine selection. Soldiers could not help but wonder, as Partington did, if maybe it was every man for himself.
A Mississippi soldier echoed this point shortly after his enlistment. "We cannot rely upon anyone with certainty. The distress everywhere prevailing has thrown every individual upon his own resources for a support, and have had the effect to isolate, it seems, every human being."
Yet their probing questions about the war's destiny and human nature rarely caused a crisis of faith or led to widespread disillusionment. Union and Confederate soldiers kept going, even when all seemed lost, relentlessly driven by a strong desire to live up to the expectations of home and their desire to preserve male honor in pursuit of military victory. Partington cherished his standing in the ranks as a man of courage, and any loss of reputation would have called into question a deeply felt and robust love that bound him to his wife, his comrades, and his nation. Duty became Partington's watchword, as it did with most Civil War veterans, because it made the job of soldiering sacred while also offering men a degree of latitude in dealing with the dilemmas of Army life. The concept of duty proved malleable, rarely triggering a mechanical or predictable course of action among veteran soldiers who knew that they did not have a prayer of surviving unless one assumed a situational view of life. In The War for the Common Soldier, I argue that Union and Confederate soldiers navigated the war with a spontaneous philosophy that can best be described as a hard-nosed pragmatism. Luke Menand was among the first historians to show the importance of pragmatism in his exceedingly important study of Union officer and Supreme Court Justice Oliver Wendell Holmes in The Metaphysical Club, A Story of Ideas in America. According to Menand, Holmes's pragmatism overshadowed his idealism by 1864, when Holmes came to distrust ideology and to value duty, experience, and professionalism above all else. Plenty of soldiers on both sides shared Holmes's veteran outlook, but their pragmatism did not compete with their idealism, as Menand's argument would suggest. Rather, I believe that pragmatism gave them the flexibility to act in ways that actually helped them preserve their faith in ideas. Adaptability, the hallmark of pragmatism, empowered soldiers to shape themselves to the ground conditions of war. Thus, the ideas themselves could bend. As Joseph Glattar has shown in his pioneering study of Sherman's army, the reworking of codes of appropriate conduct did not drain Union soldiers of their idealism. In fact, the rampant foraging and destruction of Southern property rarely descended into plundering. The men saw themselves as acting out of military necessity and legitimate retribution in order to restore the Union. Sherman's men might have been the most pragmatic in their approach to war, but they were far from alone. Adhering to a strict code of conduct proved unsustainable in the field on both sides and in all armies. To most men's shock, well-established binaries of duty or disobedience, morality or immorality, loyalty or disloyalty, and bravery or cowardice were blurred by war. Situational thinking prevailed,
but never occurred in isolation from soldiers' relationships to their households, families, and wives. The fluid ways in which soldiers read and reacted to daily life in the ranks largely drew from their hard experiences and lessons learned on the ground, making it possible for Union and Confederate soldiers to live with the contradictory elements of their violent and volatile existence in the ranks. Pragmatism also helped affirm Civil War soldiers' sense of being independent-minded citizen soldiers. This ethos drew from the example of George Washington, whose civic virtue and high-minded service set a standard Northern and Southern volunteers sought to emulate. They fashioned themselves as selfless defenders of liberty, having set aside the mundane matters of life to achieve immortal fame by defending the nation. When the crisis passed, Northern and Southern men intended to return to their civilian pursuits, just as Washington had done after the American Revolution. Life would resume after the war, but people would see them differently. They were war heroes, deserving of eternal gratitude and remembered as patriots. Sentimentalism proved incapable of reconciling the inherent tensions in the model of the citizen soldier. Wartime sentimentalists put their faith in the individual soldier's ability to rise above the dehumanizing aspects of military life through physical and moral discipline. Living with a pure heart was supposed to instill moral courage in men so that they might face battle without fear. The individualized sentimental soldier, who was always imagined as white, would fight courageously, pray fervently, and suffer silently for the national cause. If a soldier cultivated the right feelings, sentimentalists predicted that he would show himself as a man of character, whose sacrifices would demonstrate the power of willed behavior over the impersonal forces of mass organized warfare. Although sentimentalism never lost its potency in making the bodily sacrifice of the citizen soldiers sacred, it could not accommodate the extremes of the military world, where days could oscillate between sheer boredom and uncontrollable terror, between a feeling of safety and a sudden fear of death. To conclude that war's horrors kept soldiers from following an idealized cultural script is a prosaic point. The challenge is to understand how the ideas of the citizen soldier, imbued with the feelings of sentimentalism, intermeshed with the daily practices of soldiering. Northern and Southern volunteers reinterpreted the idea of the citizen soldier in ways that countered its intended meaning of strict obedience. Necessity compelled them to pursue alternatives that simultaneously deepened the hold of the citizen soldier as a practice and offered opportunities for subversion. Citizen soldiers were expected to be dutiful, yet absolute submission to authority was unthinkable to American men steeped in the idea of white liberty. Professional officers had no choice but to compromise, since volunteers insisted on having a say as to who ruled over them and under what terms. Even generous concessions could not placate volunteers, who often mistrusted their officers. Veterans came to realize that blind obedience could lead to needless death in camp or battle. As historian Catherine Meyer shows in her pathbreaking work, enlisted men thought by the seat of their pants in the field, always trying to adapt to the natural environment without regard to regulation or authority. Their spontaneous acts likely enhanced their chances of surviving, but they often put them in the crosshairs of their superiors, who dismissed self-care tactics as the mischievous shenanigans of undisciplined volunteers. The whirlwind of conflicting obligations of military life reminds us that a soldier was never a state of being, but always a process of becoming. The War for the Common Soldier considers the totality of the Civil War military experience. The idealism, the camaraderie, the boredom, the marching, the singing, the sickness, the stink, the filth, the drilling, the punishments, the hunger, the exhaustion, the frustrations of being away from their families, the mental fatigue, and the grinding poverty that caused men to forget who they were, what they looked like, and even what they used to be, all punctuated by the horrible violence that, in an instant, turned beloved comrades into unrecognizable corpses. To persevere, soldiers were continually remaking themselves as circumstances dictated. The fortunate managed to find themselves as men, husbands, and soldiers. They passed through the eye of the storm because of a pragmatic, come-what-may outlook that kept them going until either they were played out or the war was over. ideas had the power to rescue Civil War soldiers during the darkest moments of military service. Thanks to historians Joseph Glattar, Earl Hess, Reed Mitchell, James McPherson, Chandra Manning, Aaron Sheehan Dean, Francis Clark, Stephen Barry, Susanna Ural, Lorian Foote, and many others, we understand why men fought and why their reasons changed over time. We know that the defense of slavery mattered to Confederate soldiers. We have discovered that anti-slavery sentiments gained strength in Northern armies without submerging the primary commitment to Union. And we have reconstructed the dialogue between soldiers and the home front, with all of its tensions, contradictions, and expressions of mutual support. Virtually all historians agree that Civil War soldiers were not apolitical defenders of home and hearth, but complicated political beings who were deeply ideological, articulate, and driven to fight and die for high ideals. We also know how Civil War soldiers could act with incredible political solidarity at any one moment, and in the next instance, turn against their government, the people back home, and each other. Both North and South, goes an established argument, also shared a political culture of republicanism, a similar national history, a deep faith in Christianity, and a universal commitment to manly honor and duty, which instilled in Northern and Southern soldiers the fortitude to endure incredible suffering as they strove to live out their sentimental ideals about manliness, religion, and national duty. Much of this scholarship pivots around an immensely important question. What motivated Union and Confederate soldiers? We have, as a result, a deeper appreciation and understanding of the reasons why men fought and why their reasons for fighting changed over time. I did not write The War for the Common Soldier as a rebuttal to the work on soldier motivation, but I do not believe that this body of scholarship has fully recovered the life of the rank and file as it was lived. Too often, historians invest ideology and identity with an all-encompassing explanatory power. This creates the impression that soldiers acted in reflexive ways to abstractions like sentimentalism, the ideal of the citizen soldier, nationalism, and duty. In many cases, the connections between soldiers' thought and action appear mechanical and static because they fail to adequately account for the ways that beliefs and actions rose spontaneously out of particular conditions. The contingencies of soldiering, above all else, are often lost when ideological comments are extracted as transparent statements as to why men fought. Above all else, this book seeks to reconstruct the totality of the military experience by pursuing three broad questions. First, what were the cultural and ideological boundaries that framed the world as Civil War soldiers imagined it? Second, how did soldiers respond to those moments when they felt hemmed in by the sentimental expectations of society, the military's need for discipline, and the pleas for help from those at home, while also facing the pressing practical demands of trying to survive in the ranks? Third, how did soldiers intellectually and practically navigate moments of doubt, when the nature of knowledge and its relationship to truth and belief seemed incongruous with a war that overturned the idea of an orderly universe under God's direction? I respond to these questions by shifting the axis of investigation from what Union and Confederate soldiers thought to how they thought. Examining how soldiers thought is fraught with challenges, given that so much of the existing Civil War correspondence can be cataloged as terse tales that never pierce the inner world of the writer. The internalization of the war among veterans, as pervasive as it was, does not mean that any inquiry into how these men thought is beyond reach. Moving the inquiry below the content of wartime writings uncovers cultural orientations that shape, color, and organize the way people see, comprehend, and represent the world around them. My understanding of the act of writing is closely aligned with my belief that soldier letters are neither transparent windows into the workings of the author's mind, nor unmediated statements that reveal why men fought. The act of writing registers an expression of reality filtered through cultural lenses and the idiosyncratic tendencies of the writer. When less emphasis is placed on the truthfulness of a soldier's writings, it is possible to see letter writing as a creative act. Historian Arlette Farge correctly observes that greater attention should be given
to understanding how a narrative came to be articulated in the way that it was. How was it shaped by the authority that compelled it to be given, the speaker's desire to convince, and his or her pattern of speech? Farge reminds us of the importance of situating the words of Civil War soldiers within the cultural and rhetorical models of the time. It is then possible to identify the circumstances that helped create them. My approach is not an exercise in intellectual history or a study of rhetoric. Rather, analyzing the act of writing serves as a bridge between intellectual, social, and cultural history. To create a fuller contextual picture of the soldier experience, I have incorporated material and visual culture, as well as sensory and emotional history. From these varied sources and methodologies emerge the many dramas of soldiering, where men heard the diverse, confusing, and often contradictory voices, both private and public, that framed their everyday perceptions of a world fraught by turmoil. The war for the common soldier relies heavily on case studies of men of all backgrounds. Using a case study approach minimizes the cherry-picking of quotes from soldier writings, a persistent problem in the historiography that has led to a static view of Civil War soldiers as men of duty who acted on a set of beliefs in predictable and unchanging ways. I've tried to minimize this standard approach by positioning the words of soldiers within the flow of events over an extended period of time, capturing in the process the fluid nature of thought and action, while also revealing the tensions embedded in this dialectic. Above all else, a case study approach illustrates that no one man can stand for all the experiences in the ranks, and that no single individual can possibly represent the approximately 2.7 million men who served in the Union forces, and the 1.2 to 1.4 million men who stood in the ranks of the Confederate military. There was no common soldier in the Civil War. The case studies reflect a wide spectrum of social, racial, class, and regional backgrounds, and men who fought in the Eastern and Western theaters. Some soldiers came from privilege, while others were dirt poor. Most of them were well-educated, but others were barely literate, including two Confederates who dictated letters to their comrades. All of the men were reflective about their place in the ranks, but they made meaning of their experiences in radically different ways. A few deserted, but most remained in the Army, including some battlefield shirkers and medical malingerers. The majority of these men were motivated, dutiful, and committed to using the violence of war as a redemptive power for the individual and the nation. At other moments, these men were depressed and apathetic about the war. The patriotism of some soldiers cracked under the economic pressures of Army life, while other men persevered even when they and their families were destitute. The link between household and soldiers plays a critical role in almost every soldier case study. It was rare when a man did not feel the emotional pull of family and sought the approval of loved ones on the home front. There was no boundary between the home front and the Army, as the examples in The War for the Common Soldier illustrate. Ultimately, I choose the soldiers who serve as the case studies here because their letters are sufficiently rich to tell a man's story over an extended period of time. Rather than poll soldier opinion in the search of representative enlisted men, I've relied heavily on deeply contextualized stories that resemble what cinematographers call deep focus. This visual framework keeps the lens on the main figure without blotting out or blurring the background. The consequence is a narrative of greater depth, for it keeps a variety of people, institutions, and forces on center stage, enabling us to see how a soldier interacted with a cast of characters as he sized up his choices in the field. This technique helps recapture the spontaneity of the historical moment so that we may get to the ground level of war as it looked from the ranks. Some might question my reliance on men who deserted or openly contested military authority, since the vast majority of Civil War soldiers remained at their posts and rarely felt estranged from their respective causes. Such a criticism misses the value of studying soldiers seen as the Army's outliers. Case studies of shirkers and deserters mark the permissible boundaries of expression and action in Civil War armies. While each man had his own conception of the world, putting a spotlight on deserters and malingerers is crucial to understanding the experience of the majority. The words and deeds of dissenters reveal how military and cultural authority functioned,
getting us closer to what Union and Confederate soldiers imagined as available alternatives of political action. Deserters and shirkers, by their very exceptionalism, help us to understand the strategies of the dutiful, who had to make their own accommodations to military power. A final note about methodology is in order. Every page in a book has margins, and I, like any author, had to stay within them. I decided to focus on the soldiers who experienced combat in the ranks of mainline Civil War armies. As a result, I did not include soldiers who were assigned to garrison duty, veterans who served in the Invalid Corps, prisoners of war, Native Americans who aligned themselves with the Union or Confederate armies, and women who passed as men to fight in the ranks. I also did not incorporate guerrillas or partisan rangers into my narrative. My omissions should not be interpreted as dismissiveness. Scholars such as Dan Sutherland, Kenneth Noe, Leanne Weitz, Barton Meyer, Brian D. McKnight, Matthew Hulbert, and others have produced valuable work on the ways that guerrillas shaped broader military operations while working within and on household networks. The field of irregular warfare contains some of the most exciting and engaging scholarship coming out in the field of Civil War history, but unfortunately, its inclusion would have diverted attention away from my primary focus on conventional armies. I've divided The War for the Common Soldier into 7 chapters. Each chapter addresses key aspects of the soldier experience. All are tied together by a common inquiry. How did soldiering trigger shifts in attitudes, beliefs, and emotional dispositions? Chapter 1, Comrades, Camp, and Community, explores the job of being a soldier and how soldiers bent their bodies and minds to the circumstances of camp. They came to embrace a pragmatic or flexible understanding of what it meant to be a citizen soldier. Their challenges in the ranks were inseparable from the household, despite their geographical distance from home. How civilians and soldiers forged support networks of survival is at the heart of this chapter. Chapter 2, Providence and Cheerfulness, explores the ways that providential pragmatism and the emotion of cheerfulness served Northern and Southern soldiers when God's intentions appeared indecipherable. Special attention is given to the coping strategies of soldiers seeking guidance from above, while also trying to read the practical situation on the ground. Men on both sides struggled to describe these moments of crisis when the war weakened their bodies and wore down their minds. The composition of letters to family and friends and its connections to the act of soldiering are detailed in Chapter 3, Writing Home. So much of what we know of the wartime experience of Civil War soldiers comes from their writing. But in the evaluation of what soldiers wrote, it is easy to miss the equally important question of how the men wrote their stories. The manner of language, aesthetics, and writing style can tell us much about how they interacted with the sentimental culture that was so prevalent in the Civil War era. Social class and educational background proved crucial in shaping different writing aesthetics. Chapter 4, Courage and Cowardice, offers a fresh perspective on what propelled men to fight and how survivors dealt with the ghastly results of combat. The important linkages between ideas and motivation are crucial to understanding the violence of combat. But what is missing from the literature is a greater sensitivity to the forces of compulsion. Physical coercion, medical knowledge, male honor, and sentimentalism that pushed men to attack and kill in battle. As the war progressed, there was a growing awareness that willed behavior and human endurance had its limits. That a soldier's body could stand only so much punishment before his morale wavered and his body collapsed. When this occurred, soldiers referred to themselves as being broken down or used up, as if they were draft animals driven past the point of usefulness. Chapter 5, Desertion and Military Justice, examines those soldiers who risked their reputations to escape battle or to flee the army for good. The causes and consequences of desertion have been well chronicled and analyzed by scholars, but the voice of the runaway is rarely heard, especially if the man was caught and condemned to death. The intent of this chapter is to see the world through the eyes of a soldier at that moment when he decided to risk his life for the freedom of home. This chapter reveals that desertion was situational and usually a defensive measure animated by the desire to survive. How did soldiers respond to a military loss?
Chapter 6, Facing the Enemy and Confronting Defeat, suggests that members of the Union rank and file had the capacity to stand outside themselves and recognize the paradoxical effects of their own behavior on the world around them, even in the wake of defeat. They were also disposed to confess, both privately and publicly, how they were at least partially responsible for the unintended consequences of their individual actions, rather than assigning blame to the impersonal forces of war or the mysteries of providence. This kind of critical distance was much more difficult for white Southerners, whose need for reputation and whose desire for mastery kept them from deep self-criticism. Even when the material foundations of their slave system started crumbling around them, exposing the most jarring ideological contradictions of their world, Confederates, particularly of the slaveholding class, tended to frame the demise of their nation as a tragedy outside their control and beyond their responsibility. How soldiers came to terms with the end of the war is the focus of the final chapter, The Trophies of Victory and the Relics of Defeat. A discussion of veterans transitioning to civilian life does not appear here, though one will find references to a rich body of scholarship on this important subject. Rather, much of this chapter explores how soldiers dealt with the war's end through their collections of relics. Attention to the common practice of gathering artifacts reveals that Southern soldiers, though shamed by the defeat at Appomattox, recovered their reputations through mementos associated with the last days of the Army of Northern Virginia's existence. Union soldiers, on the other hand, treasured any relic associated with the war's final campaign as a way to commemorate their individual role in saving the Union. The lively trading of mementos that occurred between the former combatants also speaks to the astonishing degree of political moderation that characterized the breakup of rebel armies. The chapter concludes by following Union soldiers across Virginia to the Grand Review in Washington, D.C. During the journey, William Sherman's men became tourists for a day, visiting the famous battlefields around Fredericksburg, Virginia. The sight of shallow burial pits and a ravaged landscape was a poignant reminder of a violent world that they were finally leaving behind. Any study of the American Civil War is both blessed and cursed by a primary source base that one could describe as oceanic. The War for the Common Soldier is based on extensive research in letters, diaries, newspapers, and official documents that other scholars have utilized. I come to the sources at a slightly different angle. In every soldier letter that I read, I looked for the collision between official and unofficial stories. It is here that we can locate the dialogue that takes place between an individual and society. And this is where the tension resides between how a soldier identified with the self and how he was identified by others. Exploring the tensions between collective solidarities, such as a man's family, community, regiment, army, and nation, and his understanding of himself, is of central importance. A close examination of these pressure points exposes the many forms of power that bore down on every enlisted man through the duration of the war. John Partington again serves as a useful illustration in this regard. Throughout the course of his service, he wrote about life in the Army with a distinct ambiguity. There were plenty of inconsistencies in soldiering that proved to be troubling for Partington. He had expected the Army to pay him regularly, to issue him a livable ration, and to provide sufficient shelter from hostile conditions. In return, he would always stand by his comrades and would never turn his back to the enemy. The military, however, routinely violated this covenant, as was frequently the case on both sides during the Civil War. Therefore, there were times when Partington described a soldier's life as a world of honor, duty, and bravery, and other moments when he could not stand in the ranks without feeling empty, embittered, and alone. The ever-pressing demands of home and nation led Partington to question his place in the war and nearly pushed him to the brink of desertion. He harbored a deep resentment toward tyrannical officers. He was disgusted by the wretchedness of army life. He was appalled by the slaughter of the battlefield. At the same time, he imagined that all of the death and destruction was necessary to defeat a traitorous rebellion for the cause of Union. In having to discipline and subordinate his self while in the army, Partington assured his wife that he was becoming a decent and God-fearing man who was finally worthy of her love and respect. Unfortunately, Partington never had the chance to make amends to Sarah for all those drunken nights back in Michigan.
In a fierce melee at Gettysburg on July 1st, Confederates from North Carolina shot him down. His body was lost somewhere in the carnage of McPherson's woods. Months passed before Sarah received confirmation that her husband had been killed. A comrade from the burial party wrote that he could not find John because those I buried on the field were so changed that I should not have known his body had it been there. Partington's corpse was likely removed to an anonymous grave on Cemetery Hill, not far from where Lincoln gave his famous oration on November 19th. The power of the president's address not only resided in the words themselves, but also stemmed from the field of action where soldiers like Partington discovered the truth of their conviction in the blood sacrifices of their comrades. 1. Comrades, camp, and community. Intrigue hangs in the air over five Union soldiers manning an isolated picket post in Winslow Homer's painting, In Front of Yorktown. A gloomy backdrop of impenetrable woods deepens the sense of the unknown. The men are not sentinels stationed along the army's edge, dodging enemy sharpshooters that could steal life with one well-aimed shot. They are far enough behind the lines to build a fire and rest under a shanty. Yet they remain at a distance from the main camp of the Army of the Potomac. The men appear relaxed, even comfortable, and Homer conveys their sense of security by placing their muskets near the border of the painting, barely visible, and more importantly, beyond the quick reach of the men. Cartridge belts, scabbards, and belts dangle from some pine logs under which two men sleep soundly. The three other figures are carefully positioned around a campfire. Three trees dominate the painting's foreground, dividing the men into two distinct groups. On the left side are two enlisted men, sitting close together at the edge of the fire and conversing privately while trying to stay warm. To the right of the campfire, and physically separated from the two enlisted men, sits an officer, upright and authoritarian in posture, wearing a double-breasted overcoat and kepi sewn with the insignia of rank. Only the officer's facial features are discernible. His emotions are unknowable. He stares blankly into the flames, seemingly lost in thought. Trying to visualize the world from his vantage point is the challenge that Homer presents his audiences. What is the man contemplating? What are his calculations? Homer offers few clues. The officer is clearly preoccupied, but what thoughts engage him? Is he lost in a nostalgic dream for home? Or is he looking at the other two soldiers, whose clean uniforms suggest their newness to war? Maybe he feels the weight of an uncertain future with men that he will lead to the front. How will they respond when the shooting begins? Tensions abound in Front of Yorktown. Isolation and conflict have a strong presence, as do physical closeness and emotional intimacy. But the question of unity remains somewhat open. The contradictions and ambiguities that emerge from Homer's work point to a significant question. How did the psychological and physical demands of being a soldier in the field simultaneously unite and divide Civil War soldiers of various temperaments and class backgrounds, as they tried to live out sentimental aspirations within a world that was uncharitable as it was unpredictable? This chapter answers this broad question by examining how volunteers learned the many jobs of being a soldier, which provides a window into ways that enlisted men adapted to the everyday challenges of living in the ranks. Pragmatism figured prominently into soldier coping strategies, but pragmatism did not lead to moral relativism, the abandonment of objective truth, or the loss of patriotic ideas among members of the rank and file. Until the end of the war, they clung stubbornly to the sentimental vision of war as a moment to demonstrate the power of heroic individualism as proof of manliness and Christian character. Yet veterans came to see the limits of willed behavior within highly disciplined and hierarchical armies, where the failure to conform to military authority often resulted in a loss of pay and sometimes in corporal punishment. This chapter opens with an overview of soldier and civilian expectations of war as filtered through the cultural lens of sentimentalism and through the ideologies of their respective causes. It then considers how the organization of Civil War companies and regiments could simultaneously foster consensus and conflict among comrades. The volunteer soldiers struggle to harness their individualism and conform to the ways of professional military men, shows how surviving camp and comrades required flexibility in thought and action. The military's promotion of discipline, moral restraint, and bellicosity caught citizen soldiers off guard, for they had never contended with such radically different demands in their pre-war lives. The heart of this chapter is devoted to fleshing out this major theme through 5 case studies, 3 Union and 2 Confederate. This approach provides a variety of personal voices that are expansive enough to offer insight into the broader strategic considerations of Civil War soldiers, as they tried to muster a degree of control in an army where autonomy was circumscribed. In the wake of Fort Sumter, every Northern and Southern man who rushed to enlist knew that the eye of the crowd was on him. Any misstep could ruin reputations, bring shame down on oneself, and forever blacken a family's name, especially if the man remained at home while others did the fighting. A Louisiana soldier who served in the Trans-Mississippi Theater described the moment that he headed out the door for the Army. He confided to his diary that he could not refrain from weeping when he said goodbye to his beloved companion and our 4 little infants. His reputation demanded action. He could not stay back while others fought without risking dishonor. I will not be a reproach to the name I bear, while an invading enemy was threatening to tyrannize over us. The close association between manliness and the cause also unleashed a spirit of rage militaire among Northern men who rushed off to war with romantic dreams of glory. Shortly after his regiment was mustered into service, Pennsylvanian Amos Judson marched down the streets of Pittsburgh, imagining what the cheering crowd might be saying. There goes a splendid officer. He's a brave fellow. He'll face the cannon's mouth. And he'll dash into the enemy's ranks and come out with his sword reeking with the blood of traitors. Their expectations, Judson admitted, would likely endanger his personal safety, something that I have always nursed with the greatest care. But at that moment, he was carried away by the exhortations of the crowd, their cheers appealing to his vanity, as well as stirring his patriotism. In that instant, with flags flying overhead, martial music filling the air, and his comrades following in perfect military order, Judson felt he would not have hesitated to be blown up to glory from the jaws of a 10-inch Columbiad. Similar visions of battlefield immortality filled the heads of Union and Confederate volunteers who breathed in the heavy air of sentimentalism. Everyone wanted to return home as a conquering hero, his bayonet and sword crimsoned with the enemy's blood. The initiation into the military was the beginning of the transformation in how citizen soldiers saw themselves as men. To Northern and Southern families who sent their men off to war in 1861, it must have seemed as if their loved ones became soldiers overnight. As soon as a volunteer put on a uniform, his physical appearance showed that he had left the ranks of the civilian world for a distinct military fraternity. The coat, hat, and accoutrements were a visible connection to other soldiers, conveying a spirit of martial masculinity that imbued Northern and Southern recruits with a sense of manly pride that encouraged feelings of superiority. Even though a man's understanding of himself changed on entering the Army, departing for war did not divorce the citizen soldier from his home. As historian Reed Mitchell notes, "To be a good son, a good brother, a good husband and father, and to be a good citizen meant trying to be a good soldier." In fact, men on both sides looked to articles sewn by wives and sweethearts, especially homespun uniforms and battle flags, as tangible links to home folks. These material items served as a constant reminder that they were defending their homes and local communities for a national cause dedicated to different conceptions of liberty. The first letters to arrive from camp often included images of recruits looking determined and stern. They wore immaculate uniforms with shoulders touching, arms interlocked, and usually a pistol or bowie knife in hand. The physical intimacy of these pictures conveyed a powerful sense of solidarity with men posing as brothers in arms who were willing to die for each other in defense of family, comrades, and nation. For those at home, the likeness captured the sentimental expression of the bold soldier boy, an image idealized as the quintessence of a Civil War volunteer. He was to be brave, but not reckless. Pious, but not a zealot, disciplined, but not authoritarian, and dutiful, but not obsequious.
These early war images complemented the popular romantic stories of war, told since childhood, that helped create the illusion of bold soldier boys embarking on an adventure in which selflessness, physical strength, and pure courage would sweep away a dastardly enemy from the field of battle. Mothers and fathers helped foster sentimental fantasies among men, imploring their sons to win the love of women and the respect of the public. In letter after letter, soldiers on both sides described themselves as dutiful sons to family and to country, an idea that never lost its emotional and political resonance, even among hard-bitten veterans. Even as soldiers proclaimed that they personally felt morally rejuvenated upon entering the ranks, they quickly discovered that the army could transform an innocent choir boy into a debauched and slovenly soldier overnight. A North Carolinian soldier revealed to his cousin on January 1, 1862, that camp is anything but a place to improve a man's moral and religious feelings. It seems as if most men soon forget in camp that they have to be accountable for their words, and at least a great many for their actions. Such complaints were understandable, but soldiers and civilians drew comfort in knowing that the moral conscience of the community followed every enlistee into his company. Those at home kept close tabs on their companies through newspaper reports, letters received from the ranks, and stories from soldiers returning home on furlough. The seeds of the communication grapevine sprouted from the company, the smallest but most important unit in Civil War armies. The company was composed of men who were brothers, fathers, cousins, and childhood friends, typically from the same hometown or surrounding area. Enlisted men served under familiar and respected figures of authority. The lawyer in town, the neighboring planter, and the local businessman usually organized companies, composed of 100 men who came from all social classes. 10 companies made up a regiment that almost always reflected a broad cross-section of a particular region, town, or city. Class and social tensions did not immediately disappear once units were mustered into service. But at the same time, soldiers did not divide themselves into competing factions based on economic status. But archaeology surveys of Civil War camps reveal that officers enjoyed more luxury items and possessed more physical comforts in their quarters than enlisted men did. For the most part, however, a fluidity existed within the command structure of Civil War regiments. Resignations, battlefield death, sickness, and promotion offered men of modest backgrounds positions of leadership that were beyond reach in the civilian world. In the 20th Massachusetts Infantry, nicknamed the Harvard Regiment for its large contingent of volunteers from Cambridge, a dearth of commissioned officers after the Battle of Antietam necessitated the promotion of sergeants who came from modest backgrounds outside the environs of Boston. Those promoted included a whaler, a carpenter, a courier, a Scottish-born iron worker, a laborer, and a bootmaker. Many of the Bluebloods grumbled about the rise of the plebeians, but at least in this instance, the distinguished battle record of the latter trumped class elitism. Within these tight-knit ensembles of men, soldiers discovered that their every move was under the surveillance of communities that possessed the power to level damning judgments against its own. Soldiers who had been intensely guarded about their personal lives before the war were shocked to find little separation between their private and public lives in the army. A Pennsylvania soldier reminded his mother to keep me posted on what his furloughed comrades says about us. A grapevine of letters and rumor could entangle a soldier in ruinous gossip or promote his reputation in public as a valorous fighter. Michigan's John Partington reported on a court-martial of 6 comrades for running at Fredericksburg. "First our brigade," he explained to his wife, "was drawn up in a solid square. The prisoners were in the center. They then had their heads shaved and were drummed out before the whole of us and were disgracefully decharged from the service of Uncle Sam." One of the convicted, John noted, came from their county and was an acquaintance. "So if any of them around there should see him," Partington ordered, "let them point the finger of scorn at him." When a member of the Army of Tennessee fled for home after receiving a desperate letter from his wife, the congregation of his Baptist church called him before the parishioners. He admitted to his sin and promised to return to the ranks. Though the fear of being ostracized weighed heavily on the Civil War rank and file, they also did their duty to prove their worthiness as men, not just because of peer pressure, but also because they believed the cause was deserving of their lives.
idealism could easily surrender to regimental ambitions and politics, combustible ingredients that caused some units to explode into partisan fragments, particularly in relation to military promotions. In Union armies, Republican and Democratic soldiers formed secret alliances to advance their own candidates at the expense of a political rival. The Confederates, by contrast, had plenty of political intrigue, but the central government in Richmond, not the individual states, approved commissions. The Confederacy also lacked a two-party system, further discouraging political animosities from shackling the promotion process. In the North, the Republicans and Democrats blunted the fighting edge of their armies through a shameless use of patronage. Republican George W. Watson, for example, a lieutenant in the 90th Pennsylvania, led his men with distinction throughout the summer of 1862 after his captain fell. Protocol and merit justified Watson's promotion, but as historian Timothy Orr discovered, when Governor Andrew Curtin forwarded a captain's commission, the documentation mysteriously disappeared. The regimental colonel, Peter Lyle, put up 14 officers for promotion, all Democrats, and Watson was bypassed for a Democrat who had been absent for months and only fought in one battle. Such partisan differences, personal grudges, and long-standing feuds were quickly forgotten on the battlefield, where Civil War soldiers displayed a powerful solidarity. The Army's organizational structure fostered devotion to the unit, ensuring that blood would be shed among men who came from the same clan and community, standing shoulder to shoulder on the battlefield not as strangers, but as intimate companions who had known each other. At the same time, the very localism of Civil War regiments could also be an impediment to unity and professionalism. Men from their local neighborhoods ruled over volunteers with varying styles. Their long histories and personal relationships afforded soldiers an opportunity to settle old scores. The election of officers, in particular, injected community politics into regimental governance. Subordinating oneself to peers, especially a rival who had won a popularity contest, was difficult to swallow for American men who treasured their inflated sense of equality. Shortly after arriving in the Army of the Potomac, New York's Charles Biddlecomb promised to live as an independent man of honor, telling those at home that, as long as his officers showed him sufficient respect, he did not mind having nothing but our little dog tents to crawl into, adding, "We are well smoked up, look very greasy and dirty. Besides, we've got a few graybacks. Even my company officer says I am as capable of an office as any man they have got, but my everlasting temper keeps me from it. They know I don't care a darn for many of them. Even if I do look kindly dirty and rough, I think myself as good as they." Biddlecomb, like a number of Union and Confederate soldiers, never fully reconciled himself to losing his precious independence to West Point-trained officers. These professionals approached warfare as a military science. They believed that discipline was largely based on teaching skills to the rank and file. Learning how to properly handle a weapon or march in formation were among the many tasks that the Army considered critical to a soldier becoming disciplined and combat-ready. But a soldier was also seen as part of a machine that needed to behave in a predictable and orderly way. In other words, a disciplined soldier must display habits of deference and obedience to his officers at all times. His manners, body language, word choice, and even his physical appearance must convey a spirit of submissiveness. At the same time, there are plenty of accounts, particularly on the southern side, in which dress and comportment retained a high degree of individualism. Soldiers, moreover, showed their pragmatism in the ways they altered their uniforms to adapt to the environment and the demands of active campaigning. In his Reflections on the War, Ohio's Wilbur F. Hinman, a veteran in the fighting in Tennessee and Georgia, opened his book about a soldier named Cy with an illustration that shows how changes in a man's outward appearance reflected his move to veteran status. Under the drawing of a man loaded down with a backpack, a coffee can, a kettle, hatchet, and extra boots is the line, "How Cy started in." In the adjoining illustration, Cy has, because of active campaigning, discarded all of his superfluous belongings. He now carries only a blanket roll, canteen, and accoutrements. And the caption below reads, "How Cy came out." Professional soldiers discovered that the American volunteer was not so easy to subdue. Repeated roll calls,
relentless drilling, and the routine of practicing the manual of arms imparted discipline. But the desire to survive often kept soldiers from fulfilling the military's demand for order and fighting efficiency. The goals of both sides intersected and diverged on a daily basis, falling in and out of alignment and creating a tense and tumultuous relationship among privates and the Army's hierarchy. Some armies enforced training with greater discipline than others. Union and Confederate armies in the Western theater were often perceived as more lax than their Eastern theater counterparts. The commanding general often made the difference, and Confederate Braxton Bragg, for instance, subjected the volunteers in the Army of Tennessee to a strict regimen. A Mississippi artillerist observed that, "There's been a great improvement in regard to discipline and drill. 3 hours every day, except Sunday, each regiment, battalion, and battery is required to drill upon the field. Discipline is rigid, army movements are kept close, and General Bragg is fast bringing this volunteer army to approximate the standard of regulars." Even when a professional officer provided over an army like Bragg, whom many damned as a martinet, neither a mass rebellion nor an uprising ever occurred. With so much at stake for both sides, men could see past slights and grievances for the good of the cause. In fact, the transition from new soldier to veteran usually witnessed an acceptance of, and even an appreciation for, the strict military professionalism that was ultimately seen as crucial to their own survival. The following five narratives of Charles Hayden, William Walker, Charles Bowen, Joshua Calloway, and Christian Epperly intersect at many points, even though these men were very different in background as well as in personality. The thread that ties this chapter together is the connection between the business of being a soldier and its relationship among pragmatism and patriotic ideas. To their surprise, Northern and Southern volunteers found themselves beholden to the conditions of military life, a world where life and death choices were made, but certitude was in short supply. This was disorienting to Americans who came from a world where clear-cut laws under providential direction supposedly governed life. In war, soldiers leaned toward valuing beliefs and actions that proved through experience to be good for the cause or beneficial to one's survival. Except for William Walker, who was executed for mutiny, all of these soldiers showed remarkable adaptability in thought and action in an attempt to cope with the insecurities of soldiering. These case studies also show how the daily demands of the military could simultaneously knit men together as well as pull them apart. While remaining sensitive to the different ways that individuals interacted with the surrounding landscape and recognizing the importance of ideology and the values of sentimentalism, the portraits of Hayden, Walker, Bowen, Calloway, and Epperly reveal how the common struggles in Civil War armies centered over the control of scarce resources and soldier labor. These conflicts are situated within larger economic, military, and social structures as a way to see how these soldiers themselves imagined their options as they tried to meet the confusing and conflicting obligations to home, comrades, and army. The diverse roads taken did not follow ideological guideposts, nor were members of the rank and file culturally hardwired in uniform ways. Civil War soldiers were always improvising, in a world where the driving needs of survival could easily overwhelm established rules and practices. Charles Hayden, Michigan lawyer, 2nd Michigan Infantry. As soon as Michigan's Charles Hayden manned the picket line outside the Washington, D.C. defenses in 1861, the gap between the sentimental expectation of war as an adventure of heroic individualism and the hard reality of doing the job of a private came into focus with startling clarity. Hayden quickly learned, as all recruits did, that war was laborious work, that survival depended on steady training and obeying orders, and that simple misfortune often defeated individual heroism. These realizations did not go down well for vast numbers of Civil War soldiers on both sides, since they wanted the public to see them as independent and heroic fighters. This was Hayden's expectation when he entered the Army in 1861 as a 27-year-old lawyer and graduate of the University of Michigan. He trusted in the power of individual action and was confident that God would never relinquish his people against a vile slaveocracy. He recorded his thoughts in small memorandum notebooks that measured 5 3/8 inches, making them easy to carry in the field.
Every few months, his brother and father would receive a package in the mail containing one of Hayden's journals. Writing to a male audience freed Hayden to disclose the sordid as well as the inspiring exploits of military campaigns in Virginia and the Western Theater. During his first assignment at the front, Hayden saw plenty of questionable behavior among his men. He watched in mortification while his green soldiers fled their posts at the first hint of danger. "Some of them showed the white feather badly," he scribbled in his diary. "I would get them together and part, and while looking for the rest, some of the first were sure to sly off and hide themselves." 12 days later, all order was lost on the picket line when some of his fellow officers went on a drunken spree. Whiskey-induced negligence at the top clouded the judgment of those on the ground, and Hayden was stunned to see enlisted men initiating truces along the front to swap goods and stories with the enemy. The staggering violation of military law resulted in curious interactions among adversaries. Hayden looked on as one Confederate handed the name of his mistress in Charleston to one of his soldiers and urged him to call on her if he ever went there. It did not take long for Hayden to wash out war's romances from his journal. Unlike his Manassas entries in 1861, which were largely narratives of adventure, Hayden wrote only one dramatic account of his exploits from the front during the advance on Richmond in 1862. Forced marches and constant picket duty drove Hayden and his comrades to the point of utter exhaustion. They were jittery and emotionally ragged, and their bodies were broken down as if they had been driven like draft animals. When his detachment was relieved from the front on June 14, 1862, his body was covered with sores and blotches, and his clothes crawled with lice. Hayden pulled out his diary and wrote of his filthy uniform as a material thing, more powerful than words to convey his condition and suffering. "We are compelled to be on the alert so constantly," he wrote, "that I have ventured to sleep with pants off but once or twice since we left Fort Monroe." "Rumors," he wrote, "blew in fitful gusts across the front, convincing him that nothing he heard could be trusted, even when the information came from those who were staring at the enemy." Armies in motion, full of sleepless men, grinding back and forth, were bound to commit reckless acts out of fear and exhaustion. On the evening of June 19th, three men in Hayden's regiment were shot down by friendly fire while at their outposts. Hayden was so disgusted by these incidents and so appalled by other acts that had transpired that evening that he decided to omit any references to the tragedy in his diary. "I was along the line several times last night," he wrote, "and saw some things which, although they did not much surprise me, were anything but pleasant." By the summer of 1862, Hayden no longer imagined the picket line as a stage for acting out sentimental fantasies of adventure, nor did he sensationalize his experiences on paper as a dramatic narrative. The sentry post, above all else, had become an assignment to dread, given that the Army's perimeter was an erratic place of killing. If soldiers were to survive, they had to obey orders and master the practical skills of war. Hayden came to appreciate war as a regulated business with its own rules and protocols that could be valued only through routine experience in the field. Obeying military strictures, however, did not crush sentimental aspirations entirely. As was the case with most veterans, Hayden tempered his expectations of soldiering as a moment of individual heroism, but he never altered his self-portrait as a fearless fighter who deserved admiration from those at home. Hayden's reflections on the poem "The Picket Guard," better known as "All Quiet Along the Potomac Tonight," shows how he straddled two worlds, one regulated by the mandates of being a professional soldier, and the other of an idealistic volunteer driven by the emotional forces of sentimentalism and individual valor. Hayden was so moved by the poem that he pinned a copy to the inside cover of his diary. The piece tells the story of a lone picket stealthily moving along the rocky banks of the Potomac. On stopping under a moonlit sky, he says a prayer for his family, causing a tear to fall from his eye, just as a concealed rifleman guns him down. The man was left to die an isolated death for his nation. It is significant that when Hayden turned to his diary for reflection, his commentary focused almost exclusively on the technical components of soldiering, the pressing and overwhelming tasks of survival, not the sentimental death of the soldier in the verse, are what claimed his attention. The poem,
according to Hayden's interpretation, was significant in offering practical instruction as to how a man might save himself from getting needlessly killed. The only safety for pickets in such cases lies in frequently and noiselessly shifting his position, he observed in his diary. In this way, a lurking enemy, while looking for him in one place, is pretty sure to be seen by him from another. It needs a keen-witted, fearless, wide-awake man for a good picket guard on a dangerous post. The notion that physical bravery and cunning distinguished men on the picket line surely appealed to Hayden's sentimental desire for individual heroism. But he also looked to the Army's perimeter as a crucial testing ground where green recruits remade themselves into professionals. Harnessing individualism through the Army's bureaucratic structures was necessary, he concluded, if recruits were to fight efficiently and effectively. Those seeking personal adventure would likely get themselves or others needlessly killed. Hayden might have understood his own transformation into a soldier better than most men, yet he never lost his high ideals or questioned the political cause for which he was suffering. In late 1862, he occupied a dangerous post in Kentucky, where Confederate guerrillas arbitrarily shot down Union pickets. The pages of his journal show no trace of sentimental rush, just grim entries of death, drudgery, and despair. Hayden's war had become a cold struggle of survival. All one can hope for here at present, Hayden observed on April 18, 1863, is merely to preserve life, that is, to stay along from day to day. We wander around with overcoat and gloves on, or sit shivering around a smoky fire from morning till night, and then sleep cold till morning, then repeat the same performance. When Hayden looked across the river and watched the Confederate pickets walking their beat, he did not aspire for individual laurels or imagine daring raids against the enemy. The sentimental impulse barely flickered as he wondered if they have as dull times as we. Hayden, who would die in a military hospital of pneumonia in 1864, had seen too much and lost too many friends to abandon the cause. Alas, how many unpleasant things have we learned in the dear school of experience, he wrote in his diary on April 18, 1863. Our regiment and the whole army will fight well, he wrote, but it is with the dogged obstinacy of veteran troops having prescribed duty to perform, and not with the hilarity and confidence which used to characterize our movements. Hayden was not becoming disillusioned. He knew that the Union cause was right and worthy of his life, but at the same time, he found a higher purpose in his ability to do his duty as a man who now saw himself not as a volunteer, but as a veteran soldier. Charles Bowen, New York farm laborer, 12th United States Regular Infantry. In the weeks that followed the disastrous Union defeat at the Battle of Fredericksburg on December 13, 1862, New Yorker Charles Bowen awoke every morning feeling weary and foul, greeted by a panoramic view of Mary's Heights, a place he damned as Burnside's Slaughterhouse. Bowen had spent the night on the battlefield, taking cover behind a corpse whose whole top of his head was carried off by a shell. The eyes were open and stared at me whenever I looked at him. The next morning, when the Union Army began its retreat, Bowen slipped into town, where he joined his comrades in a looting frenzy. Bowen stole food, booze, and books. In one abandoned house, he listened to a drunken comrade, whom he mockingly called a bold soldier boy, play Root Hog or Die on a piano. To his wife, he admitted, I got considerably up on my bottle of wine and felt as good as General Burnside or any other man. Bowen's brazen disregard of military law and authority is startling, but his example shows how Civil War soldiers, when weighted down by extreme mental and physical stress, reworked notions of duty to meet the exigencies of the moment. Bowen, like so many other Americans, could never have imagined that he and the soldier boys of 1861 would have embarked on a rampage with such a wild and fierce joy. Since the battle, he had felt sad and lonely, missing his wife, Kate, who was caring for their infant daughter in Utica. Christmas did not bring him any cheer. No treats or delicacies could be procured from the settler, and no packages had arrived from home, though his captain did bring some joy by brewing 5 gallons of community whiskey. The bacchanal broke the tedium, but it could not permanently distract Bowen from the grim situation facing his army and nation.
He looked for any chance to flee, believing that the entire northern nation had abandoned him and his army. But how are they, Union soldiers, used by their government? He wrote. Not paid in months, when many have families to support who are starving for the money, which is so basely held back by red tape. All their good generals taken from them and left to be butchered by the blunders of some nincompoop of a man whose only fort is serving under a general who can order him what to do. Marched and countermarched all winter with no shelter but a dirty little shelter tent, so called, and to no purpose but to kill the men by exposure and fatigue and useless battles. It is more than human strength and patience can bear in silence, and I tell you that it finds vent in expressions now. But the time is not far distant, if this way of carrying on the war is held too, when acts will take the place of expletives. And then, the war will be finished, because Jeff Davis will have no one to fight. Bowen's outcry against the war was tied into an ugly knot of grievances and disappointments, ranging from poor conditions to poor generalship, a callous bureaucracy, and an indifferent home front. I did once blame deserters, he wrote to his wife on January 27th. But as time passes away and shows more and more plainly the corruption of some of our chief officials, I can blame no man for leaving the rotten old hulk and worse than drunken crew who man it. His cynicism even darkened his view of providential intervention, believing that God had delivered them from the rebels by unleashing a massive rainstorm in January that sunk the army in roads of bottomless mud. And I do think that we have providence on our side, for had not this opportune rain come when it did, we would have been taken across the river to what the boys call another Burnside slaughterhouse, and many of us today would be laying beneath Virginia mud, while others would have been groaning in a hospital bunk. All things considered, Bowen should have headed to Canada as he had promised to do on numerous occasions. But understanding why he stayed requires us to follow in Bowen's tracks, to see his strategic options within the military system, a soldier's economy, and a sentimental culture that constrained choices without silencing the voice of duty. Ironically, it was the daily acts of being a soldier, which Bowen and other men endlessly groused about, that forged solidarities in the ranks that no man could easily break, even when the war news was desperate and gloomy. When Bowen surveyed his camp, he stood in awe of the heroic endurance of his comrades. For in their hardship, there was no gray area, no mystifying rumor, and no trickery of confidence men and malingerers, but an indisputable display of Union soldiers realizing the sentimental dream of soldiers coming in touch with gentle emotions like sympathy when confronting suffering. While riding home from Fredericksburg, Bowen was drawn to the plight of a poor comrade who took on extra laundry work for a few shillings to support his impoverished wife and 5 children in Minnesota. How hard it is for some who have large families to support to be kept out of their pay for 6 months more at a time, and keep receiving letters from home begging for money to buy bread and meat for their starving little ones, Bowen observed. This man I speak of is one of those unfortunates. He cannot read writing and always brings me his letters to read to him, and many a one I have read that would bring tears from stone. Such is war, cruel, heartless, bloody war, that starves the innocent and enriches the guilty. Even as a hardened veteran, Bowen was like so many other soldiers who never lost their ability to feel for all men who were subjected to the cruelties of war. It was easy for Bowen to empathize with his impoverished comrade. He too was in a precarious situation after Fredericksburg, walking around camp nearly barefoot, with his shoes and socks in tatters, and his hands freezing because he could not afford a new pair of gloves made of common sheepskin. They cost $1.50 from the settler, an exorbitant price. He complained to his wife when he could have purchased the same pair for 50 cents at home. Boots were as high as $8 a pair, an outrageous sum, Bowen thought, given that the workmanship was of a very poor 20-shilling sort. I would wear the government shoes until doomsday before paying such prices, he promised. Every day, Bowen eagerly awaited the mail, desperate for a package of clothing and foodstuffs, because he could not subsist off the army's ration and its uniform allowance. At the same time, his family depended on his wages, but his pay was never regular and always insufficient. He supplemented his income through gambling, and although he had seen many foolish men squander their money in rigged games,
Bowen boasted to his wife that he had bested a notorious card sharp. Even when he was on a hot streak, the New Yorker complained of living on the brink of poverty. Bowen's problem was a universal one for members of the rank and file, who are always vulnerable to a cycle of debt. Too often, cash-hungry soldiers secured credit from regimental and brigade settlers to buy necessities at grossly inflated prices, while also having to pay the army for lost or destroyed equipment. When the paymaster made one of his infrequent visits to camp, soldiers, especially new recruits, were astonished by how little cash was received in hand. Empty pockets did not just affect material wants. They also constrained political options, especially for poor men who could not afford to desert without casting their families into a state of destitution. On reaching Canada, a Union soldier who deserted after Fredericksburg received a frantic cry for help from his penniless wife, who was stranded in New York. "I cannot live in this old shanty," she wrote. "This little bit of a hole of six little ones and myself. I cannot stand it. I shall not live a month." There were scores of poor Confederate soldiers who confronted similar financial considerations when deciding whether or not to desert. A North Carolinian, after Gettysburg, spelled out the financial realities of deserting when he wrote, "We are all out of money here. I think as soon as they get money, a lot of them will leave, as that is all that has kept them here this long." In the same vein, Bowen likely never imagined that in the army he would have to turn to gambling in order to survive. He appears to have been fairly successful, but his letter kindly did not reveal to his wife the days when fortune had turned against him. In time, Bowen's living situation stabilized in his Fredericksburg camp, but his anger toward the army and the government did not fade. Yet he still refused to defy the military by deserting, even as he called for peace. "The army is only anxious for one thing to occur, and that is the termination of the war, for they argue that in the way things are going on, there is no prospect of conquering a peace," Bowen explained on February 23rd. The words "conquering a peace" are critical, for they affirm his faith in the Northern armies to subdue the South as long as the soldiers were given the necessary support. "We want peace, or we want a draft of every ably bodied man in the North from 18 to 45, and with McClellan at our head, we'll sweep the South clean out of every root and branch of both treason and—"
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.